This award is in recognition of untiring efforts to advance the cause of liberty and raise the level of public policy debate in the Bahamas and around the world. It gives me great pleasure to present this award to Lawrence Reed.
Oh.
But I can leave it here if you want.
Just thank you, Sydney. Wow, golly. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This was a surprise. He caught me with a mouthful of chicken.
thank you.
Wow.
It's very heavy.
I don't know if you could all see it, but wow, it's a globe. Thank you. But now the problem is I'm speechless and I'm supposed to give one. Thank you so much. I'm deeply honored. I appreciate that very much. Thank you. Thank you.
It's my pleasure to ask Leandra Asfatis to please introduce our speaker.
Good evening, everyone. I'm just clearing the peas and rice from my teeth. And I want to thank the staff of the British Colonial Hotel for producing a lovely meal tonight. This is our first annual lecture in memory of Joan Thompson. And Joan Thompson is a woman I've known all my life, just getting longer. And first I was, as a young girl, I was a friend of her eldest daughter, Juliana. And then in my young adult years, I was a friend of her daughter, Jennifer. And in my more adult years, I think I would like to say I was a friend slash daughter of Joan herself. And what impressed me about Joan, there are a number of things about Joan that could easily impress you. One of my earliest memories of her was as a successful entrepreneur. And in my day and age, frankly, not too many white women went out, married white women went out and started a business on their own and were very successful at it. She was one of the few, and I don't say that to mean that the wives who stayed home and worked very hard at raising children or any other wives who did anything else, but Joan was exceptional for her age, and she was exceptional and continued to be exceptional in many respects. Joan lived well, and when I say she lived well, I don't mean she lived extravagantly, but she lived her beliefs. She was committed to her family, she was committed to excellence, and she was committed to her business and business ideals. And when later on she was introduced to the ideas of the Foundation for Economic Freedom, which my mother actually started a small group that had contact with the Atlas Foundation, Joan became a part of that group, and she picked up the idea and she ran with it, and hence we have the Nassau Institute. And I'm grateful that those two old friends gave birth to this very, I think, important think tank, that we've introduced a new level of conversation in the politics of the Bahamas, which is very much needed. It raises politics above personalities and mudslinging, and introduces the idea of concepts and policies that are beneficial to the Commonwealth. We are dealing with the Commonwealth, or the wealth of what should be common to all people. And I want to thank Joan and remember her for that. And when I say she lived well, she was also a very loyal person, but she was never extravagant. I remember many occasions since I moved my law practice out to Sandyport, I'd call her on the phone to have a chat with her on the way home, because it's a long drive from Sandyport to Winton. And we would chat. And by the time I was about parallel with Sands Seed and Seeker's End, she'd say, "Oh my God, you're on your cell phone. This is costing you money. I must hang up." And she would hang up. And that was the Joan I knew. Very, very engaging, very passionate, very clear in her beliefs, and very loyal in her friendships and to her ideals. And I thank God for Joan, and I miss her every day. Anyway, it's my honor now tonight to introduce Larry Reed, one of her favorite economist, who's taken the opportunity and given us the favor of gracing us with her presence. And if I can just read you quickly his brief introduction here. Larry Reed, or Lawrence, became president of FEE in 2008, that FEE, the Foundation for Economic
Education.
It's what? Education. In 2008, after serving as chairman of its board of trustees in the 1990s, and both writing and speaking for FEE since the late 1970s. Prior to becoming FEE's president, he served for 20 years as president of the McKinnock Center for Public Policy in Midland, Michigan. He also taught economics full-time from 1977 to 1984 at Northwood University in Michigan, and chaired his Department of Economics from 1982 to 1994. He holds a BA in economics from Grove City College, 1975, and an MA degree in history from Slippery Rock State University, 1978, both in Pennsylvania. He holds two honorary doctorates, one from Central Michigan University, 1993, and Northwood University, 2008. A champion for liberty, Reed has authored over 1,000 newspaper columns and articles, and dozens of articles in magazines and journals in the United States and abroad. His writings have appeared in the Wall Street Journal, the Christian Science Monitor, USA Today, Baltimore Sun, Detroit News, and Detroit Free Press, among many others. He has authored or co-authored 7 books, most recent ones being Excuse Me, Professor, Challenging the Myths of Progressivism and a Republic, and A Republic, another title, If We Can Keep It. He is frequently interviewed on radio talk shows and has appeared as a guest on numerous television programs, including those anchored by Judge Andrew Napolitano and John Stossel on Fox Business News. Reed has delivered at least 75 speeches annually in the last 30 years in virtually every state and in dozens of countries, from Bulgaria to China to Bolivia. His best-known lectures include 7 Principles of Sound Policy and Great Myths of the Great Depression, both of which have been translated into more than a dozen languages and distributed worldwide. His interests in political and economic affairs have taken him as a freelance journalist to 81 countries on 6 continents. He is a member of the prestigious Mount Pelerin Society and an advisor to numerous organizations around the world. He served for 15 years as a member of the board and for 1 term as president of the State Policy Network. His numerous recognitions include the Champion of Freedom Award and the McKinnock Center for Public Policy and the Distinguished Alumni Award for Grove City College. He is a native of Pennsylvania and a 30-year resident of Michigan, and now resides in Newnan, Georgia. And as a postscript, I was informed, I think reliably, that Larry was inspired to take up the cause of economic freedom when he saw the movie Sound of Music, and how the Nazis decided to victimize the Von Trapp family. And I'm hoping, you know, at the end of the evening, he will lead us in a chorus from the Sound of Music. Please welcome Mr. Reed.
Thank you, Leandra. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Leandra. Thank you, Rick. Thank you, Sydney. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I am just so deeply honored by what you've given me tonight. I just can't thank you enough. I appreciate it tremendously. I must say, however, it's an even higher honor to be the first lecturer in the series named for our late friend Joan Thompson. And it's perhaps especially fitting that Rick has asked me to talk about real heroes tonight, because Joan Thompson was exactly that. A real hero, a hero who was in our midst not so very long ago. I recall meeting with Joan at her home at least once, and many times at events that the Nassau Institute has put on here in town. And she was just a trooper for liberty. So all of you who knew her well, I want to extend our condolences from Fee. But she left behind an incredible legacy of inspiration. And I know that the Nassau Institute will continue to build on that, and she would be very proud of what I know you will accomplish in the years to come. Well, tonight I want to talk to you about real heroes. Oh, first I should mention the book that is at your table. I hope you'll have a chance to look at it. It has given me some hope in recent weeks because it has done so well. John Stossel gave a little plug on his program a week and a half ago, and it suddenly, after 6 months on the market, it suddenly became a number one bestseller on Amazon in several categories, so it's doing rather well. And last week when I was speaking to an audience in Colorado about the subject of the book, somebody asked me during the Q&A if my next one would be entitled, "Excuse Me, Bernie." And then somebody, yeah, maybe that'll be the next one. Or, "Excuse me, Donald," that would be another good one. Maybe I'll do both. But I hope you will enjoy that. It's intended for college students, but really people of any age, I think, will find it very informative. But college students are so often harangued by overwhelmingly progressive professors on one campus after another. And that book is designed to sort of give them the facts and the figures, the arguments, the ammunition they need to hopefully speak up from time to time and say, "Excuse me, Professor, that's not exactly right." We'll see. Well, at Fee, we are running a series every Friday, have been now for about 9 months. It has another 3 or so months to go. Under the banner Real Heroes, you can see all of the 40 plus editions already if you go to fee.org every Friday, and a new person is added to the list. I firmly believe that not only do we have heroes who need to be recognized, both living and from the past, but that we need heroes. If we're to go forward with the message of liberty, we need to have an optimistic message. We need to be able to point to real people and say, this isn't just a theory. There have been real people who have stood steadfast for liberty, and sometimes at enormous cost to themselves, at enormous risk to their lives, to their properties, and their honor. And we need to remember them, and that's the purpose of that series. And so tonight, I'm just going to give you a little bit of a taste. Put a couple notes down here in the hope that you may go to the website and read up on some of these fascinating people. I'll just have time tonight to talk about a very few. But they include both men and women. They include people who are living and people from the past. They include people from all corners of the world, from ancient Rome to modern Europe, America, and South America, and people of all races. Heroism is not the province of any one particular country or sex or faith. Heroes have been with us throughout history and in all corners of the globe. What defines a hero? In my mind, for a person to be a hero, it takes more than simply a particular moment in their lives. I look for people who have lived long and heroic lives, who not only have made the right judgment at perhaps a critical moment, but also have lived lives of honor and honesty or humility or patience or courage, some of the other attributes that I think define strong character and that make for a real hero. So you'll see some of those themes in the stories that I want to share with you tonight and in the series that appears on the website. The first one I want to talk about is from the very distant past, and his name is Marcus Tullius Cicero. Cicero, the greatest defender of the Roman Republic in its latter days, as it was crumbling under the pressures and the expense of an expanding welfare warfare state. Cicero was born in 106 BC in a place called Arpinum, about 100 miles south of Rome. He became a very successful lawyer, made a name for himself in his 20s in a couple of very important cases. One, in his early 20s, he was defending a man who was accused of murdering his father. The evidence looked overwhelming, but it turned out that it was all trumped up, and Cicero was able to prove in court that, in fact, the real murderers had ties to the people in the highest authority in the Roman government. He was really taking on the Roman state at a very difficult time in its history, but he won that case. Later, he was on the other side of the bench, you might say, in prosecuting a case against a provincial governor by the name of Verus. And Cicero's famous arguments in that case are still read in law schools today. Verus was a provincial governor, a man of considerable authority, who had abused his position, was corrupt to the core, but had friends in high places and figured that he could get away with his crimes. Cicero took him on in court and made the case so compelling that Verus fled before the court could render a judgment. I don't know what actually happened to him, but Cicero was credited with having uncovered the evidence that proved that Verus, in fact, was tremendously corrupt. Thereafter, because of the man's integrity, Cicero was catapulted through one elected office in the ancient Roman Republic after another, made his way all the way to the very top, and became one of two consuls in ancient Rome, the highest position that one could aspire to in the Roman Republic. In those days, and for about 500 years, the Roman government had two people at the top, and that stemmed from the time when Rome overthrew the Etruscan monarchs hundreds of years before, and didn't want thereafter to ever centralize power in the hands of a single person. So they said, we're going to have two guys at the top. We'll call them both consuls. Each one can veto the decisions of the other. And furthermore, they said, we're going to have term limits. They can't serve more than 1 year. This is an important hallmark in the rise of the ancient Roman Republic and persisted for almost half a millennium. Cicero was elected consul, and in the first 6 months, he's faced with an unbelievable crisis. A fellow senator by the name of Catiline had hatched a conspiracy to take over the Roman government. He had his own army, and it was set to march on Rome. They were going to assassinate a good portion of the Senate. Catiline was going to ascend to the top authority, declare the Roman Republic finished, and make himself dictator. Cicero gathered the evidence, presented it to the Senate, and with Catiline present, for his first of several orations, he lambasted him for his conspiracy. Catiline ends up fleeing the Senate, trying to marshal his army thereafter, but is killed on the battlefield. Cicero is given, for a very, very brief time, effectively dictatorial powers in Rome to defeat this conspiracy. As soon as he dispatched Catiline, he walked away from that power, and became known thereafter as father of the country. He was given an award effectively with that as its title. He was venerated for years thereafter. He began to write a considerable amount. In fact, there are more writings of Cicero in existence today than those of any other man or woman who lived before the year 1000 AD. Voluminous writer. In fact, when Gutenberg printed the Bible as his first product of the newly invented printing press in the 15th century. The Bible was first, but the second thing he printed on that first printing press was Cicero's De Officiis, which is still a great read today. I don't have the passage with me, but there's one in there where he talks about the importance of private property and essentially says that the first duty of government is to secure every man, every woman in their property, and not to make war on private property. Cicero gifted us with many ideas of limited government and the importance of free and responsible citizens in a republican society. You might imagine then that as the Roman Republic crumbled around him, with more and more Romans having discovered that they could vote themselves a living, not just work for one, that he would become unpopular. And certainly in the highest reaches of power in the first century BC, Cicero was unpopular. Julius Caesar tried to get Cicero to join in his collaboration, his conspiracy, to rule Rome. Cicero refused. Of course, Julius Caesar was named briefly dictator for life by the Senate. That lasted 1 month until he was assassinated. Mark Antony succeeded him, and he too was a power-hungry madman who decides to go after Cicero. But not before Cicero goes before the Senate and delivers a series of 14 philippics, as they're known, castigating Mark Antony as a would-be emperor, trying to revive the interest in, on the part of the Roman people, in the old principles of the Roman Republic. Antony dispatches an assassin to take him out, and that happens in 43 BC when Cicero is assassinated. If you remember from your history that Rome, the Roman Republic, actually fell to be followed by the Empire, and if somebody asked you, well, when did the Roman Republic end? You might say, well, it was when Julius Caesar was declared dictator, or maybe it was when Augustus became the first emperor some years thereafter. I think a more effective argument can be made that the Roman Republic ended when its last clear voice of courage, Marcus Tullius Cicero, was assassinated in 43 BC. There was no turning back. At that point, the Republic had no strong voice. The Empire followed. Within 100 years, with several emperors behind them, the Senate actually deliberated over whether or not to restore the old Roman Republic, and decided not to. And the main reason was the mobs want their handouts. The mob out there wants a strong man who will give them what they're clamoring for, games and gifts at public expense. So I think Cicero should be remembered as a great defender of liberty at a time when it was extraordinarily risky to do so. He may have succeeded in forestalling the end of the Roman Republic by a matter of a few years or decades. So you might say, what's the big deal? But he ranks as one of the greatest philosophers of liberty in the history of humanity. He left a legacy that I think we can study and follow and emulate to this day. So he's, in my mind, a real hero. Real heroes don't have to be people, say, in the military. There are many heroes who have carried arms into battle, but there are heroes in many walks of life. Cicero was one, though not one on the battlefield. A more recent one, I want to share with you some of the women that I've written about in this series, because heroes are not just men. I think there are probably just as many women who have been heroes in various walks of life over the years. Let me give you several. How many of you have heard the name Martha Coston, C-O-S-T-O-N? Yeah, that was my reaction about a year ago. I hadn't heard of her either. But I did a little research into her, and at a time when women in business in early America were extraordinarily uncommon, Martha Coston really came forward, became one of our first, in America at least, our first female entrepreneurs. She started out in the very early 1800s as an inventor, but that came later, more of necessity. Her husband died tragically young, leaving behind Martha and five kids. But within the next 2 years, two of the children died. And now Martha, penniless, with three children to care for in the 1820s, has to somehow pull things together. Her husband had been experimenting in the science of flares, signal flares. Those are very important today. We take them for granted. But back in those days, if a ship wanted to communicate with another in fog, or with a ship or the shore that was too far away to be seen by signal flag, they effectively couldn't. So Martha picked up where her husband left off and perfected not only signal flares that could be set up by a ship or from the shore to signal a ship, but not only the signal flares, but also a kind of Morse code. She developed the entire code system whereby with various signals, signal flares of different colors, you could send messages in great detail. The U.S. Navy actually became one of her biggest customers in the year thereafter, but a few years thereafter. She had not only perfected the invention, she then started a company. At a time when women didn't do such a thing, she actually had to use a pseudonym sometimes to get meetings with other men, other business people. She'd have to use a male name until they met, and then they'd say, "What? I thought you were Joe." "No, I'm Martha." But she had to do that just to get in the door sometimes. So she had to fight some customs of the day that made it a bit difficult for her. But she did an extraordinary job at marketing her signal flares, not only to the U.S. government and private merchant marine companies, but also governments and companies all over Europe and South America. There's a bit of a tragedy, though, to Martha Costin, but it's also a tribute to her. When the Civil War came, Martha Costin is all of a sudden selling huge numbers of flares to the Navy Department for the Northern government. But you know, the Northern government also decided to pay for a lot of the materials it needed by printing greenback paper money. It didn't take the Navy very long to realize, this stuff is going down in value pretty fast. So let's sign a contract with people like Martha Costin, but let's hold up payment. We'll pay our bills later, put them off as far as we can into the future, so that we can pay them in cheaper and cheaper dollars. In the end, in spite of repeated appeals by Martha Costin, even going to Congress, to be paid, they settled at the equivalent of about 20 cents on the dollar. So think of that. She got ripped off by her own government. But she was such a good marketer and a good businesswoman, it never sent her into bankruptcy. She was able to market elsewhere sufficiently to survive the U.S. government's lack of full payment. Remarkable woman who I think should not be forgotten. Here's another woman from more recent times. Have you heard the name Vivian Kellams? Vivian Kellams was the godmother, you might say, of the modern tax resistance movement in the United States. She too was an inventor. In the 1920s or 30s, she invented a cable grip that would lift large cables and suspend them. And she started the Kellams Cable Grip Company in Stonington, Connecticut to market this. She sold a ton of them to the U.S. government in the war because they were adapting them to lift up heavy artillery shells. After the war, under the Truman administration, tax withholding became compulsory. Businesses had to withhold taxes from their employees. Of course, you probably have that too here in the Bahamas, right? We've had it now for decades. Vivian Kellams went on the warpath when that became compulsory. She held a press conference in Chicago and gave this huge speech to a large audience saying that this was unconstitutional. She said if high tax Harry, by whom she meant Harry Truman, the president, if high tax Harry wants me to be his tax collector, he's got to pay me to do it and I want a badge. And her argument was that it was no business of the federal government to be compelling businesses to raise their tax revenue for them. She said, I'm not an unpaid tax collector. You send the bill to the employees. And of course, she had a less than hidden agenda, too. She thought that if they can force me to withhold taxes out of every paycheck for my employees, it's going to hide the real cost of government to employees. The government ought to just send them a bill once a year, so they're shocked into realizing how big the government's getting. That was part of her reason for doing this. Well, the IRS went after her and actually seized a bank account with tens of thousands of dollars in it. She took them to court and actually won and compelled the IRS to pay her back. She continued that fight until the early 1970s, when the U.S. Tax Court basically settled the issue against her, and we have withholding today that's hardly ever questioned. But she didn't take on just the federal government and just on that issue. Vivian Kellams was a principled, she was like a Joan Thompson in the sense that liberty animated her every moment of every day. And she would speak out against encroachments by government at any level against the liberty of the citizens. There was a time in the 50s when the legislature of Connecticut passed a law that said women cannot work after 10 p.m. Well, Vivian had an awful lot of women working for her in her Stonington, Connecticut plant, and they were fiercely loyal to her. And she thought the government had no business telling women when they could work and when they couldn't. So what'd she do? She never had a night shift, but now she got one. And she called her employees out and they started working night shifts, hoping that the government would send the cops so she could have reason for action and sue the state of Connecticut. Well, they didn't want to touch Vivian Kellam. She already had a reputation of fighting the federal government. So day after day of this went by, no cops. So Vivian Kellams decides, you know, I want them to come after me somehow so I can challenge this, make a big deal of it, hopefully get it overturned. So you know what she did? She decided then that at this point she's a multimillionaire, successful businesswoman. She goes out and gets a job as a waitress at an all-night restaurant and dares the Connecticut state government to arrest her. Within 2 days, the legislature repealed the law. And that was entirely because of the fuss that Vivian Kellams, the principal fuss that Vivian Kellams raised. A great woman who deserves to be remembered. How many of you have heard the name Harriet Tubman? Yeah, she's probably the best known, maybe worldwide, of the names I've mentioned so far. Harriet Tubman was a remarkable woman who was born into slavery in Maryland, was treated on many occasions very brutally, in fact was once beaten with a metal object on her head. I mention this because there's something that happens later in her life that stems from that, that I'll come back to. But she decided at age 29 she'd had enough. And so she was going to make a run for it, and she did. And she escaped and made her way into Pennsylvania, and then from there to some other northern states. But Harriet Tubman was not the kind of person who would say, well, I've made out okay now, so I can just kind of settle down and forget the others I left behind. Not at all. She became the most renowned conductor of the so-called Underground Railroad, the network of trails, river crossings, you name it, that brought thousands of people out of bondage into freedom in northern states and into Canada. Before she's done doing this, she will rescue about 75 people from slavery. She made 13 ventures back into slave states herself at the risk of her life to connect with people who wanted to be free and then to help them find their way to freedom. She later wrote, "I was free, but there was no one to welcome me to the land of freedom when I first escaped. I was a stranger in a strange land, and my home, after all, was down in the old cabin quarter with the old folks and my brothers and sisters. But to this solemn resolution I came. I was free, and they should be free also. I would make a home for them in the north, and the Lord helping me, I would bring them all here. Oh, how I prayed then, lying all alone on the cold, damp ground. Oh, dear Lord, I said, I haven't got no friend but you. Come to my help, Lord, for I'm in trouble. Oh, Lord, you've been with me in 6 troubles. Don't desert me in the 7th. She later was very proud of being able to say that as a conductor on the Underground Railroad, she never ran the train off the track and never lost a passenger. I'm sure you've all heard of the great abolitionist Frederick Douglass. In 1868, 3 years after the official abolition of slavery and the end of the Civil War, Frederick Douglass paid tribute to Harriet Tubman with some beautiful words that underscored her heroism. Here's what he said. "Most that I have done and suffered in the service of our cause has been in public, and I have received much encouragement at every step of the way. You, on the other hand, have labored in a very private way. I have wrought in the day, you in the night. I have had the applause of the crowd and the satisfaction that comes of being approved by the multitude, while the most that you have done has been witnessed by a few trembling, scarred, and footsore bondsmen and women, whom you have led out of the house of bondage, and whose heartfelt God bless you has been your only reward. The midnight sky and the silent stars have been the witnesses of your devotion to freedom and of your heroism." What a wonderful thing to say about anybody. Well, I told you there's something further to the incident involving being hit in the head at a young age by that metal object. That incident gave Harriet Tubman, for the next half century, frequent migraines, blurry vision. She resolved in her 70s to have brain surgery to try to fix it. Okay, this is in the 1890s. She's going to have brain surgery. But the most remarkable thing about this is she refused anesthesia. And I have a quote from her. And she lived another 15 years after this successful brain surgery prevented the migraines from coming back. Her vision recovered. It was a very successful operation. She said on more than one occasion during the 15 years thereafter that she still lived, she said, "Yeah, they lifted up the top of my skull, played around in there, and now I feel just fine." Well, what a hero, all the way to the very end. A woman who wouldn't, I don't know why, but just would not take any anesthesia, just bit down on a bullet while they operated on her brain. Harriet Tubman may soon adorn the $10 bill in the United States. Her name is on a short list to be the first woman on American currency. We'll know within the next couple of years, and that note is scheduled to come out in 2020. I think she'd be a fine candidate for that, and would bridge racial divides and bring everyone together. She was a gem and a hero in every way. One last thing, you might say, well, okay, after slavery ended, what did she do other than have that operation? She spent the rest of her life to her dying day in various charitable activities, helping other people of all colors who needed assistance in her neck of the woods. She was known as one of the greatest charitable women of that day, a truly remarkable woman. How many of you have heard of Fanny Crosby? Okay, another remarkable woman. Fanny Crosby died just 101 years ago this week. At the time of her passing in 1915, she was regarded across the country, across the United States, as perhaps the most revered woman in America. Everybody knew who she was and had for decades. In the 1870s, she made a name for herself when New York City broke out with a cholera epidemic, and Fanny Crosby, unlike so many thousands, fled the city. She stayed behind and ministered to and treated the sick, contracted cholera herself, but recovered. If that's all she ever did, she deserves surely a footnote, at least in New York City history. Fanny Crosby also knew more American presidents than any other person that anyone has been able to discern, living or dead. Counting Barack Obama, who's our 44th, we've had 43 men as president. That's Grover Cleveland counts twice, so 43, even though Mr. Obama's the 44th. How many of those 43 presidents would you guess this record holder, Fanny Crosby, actually met? 21. She met almost half the men who've ever been president of the United States. Every president from John Quincy Adams, whom she met years after he was president when he was a congressman from Massachusetts, all the way from John Quincy Adams to Woodrow Wilson. Well, that suggests, wow, why? I mean, these were men who sought her out. What did she do that would cause such people of high authority to want to get to know her? Fanny Crosby to this day holds the record for having written the lyrics to more songs than any other person living or dead. In her case, they were almost all hymns. She wrote almost 9,000 hymns, including some that you may have sung yourself. To God be the glory, blessed assurance. But the most remarkable thing about Fanny Crosby is that she never had any recollection of having seen anything. She was completely blind from the age of 6 months. Never saw a thing. And she often remarked later, when asked about her handicap, that she felt it was a blessing, that she just couldn't imagine all the things she might have missed if she had been blessed with sight. What an attitude. She was also, by the way, the first woman to address the United States Congress. And you know what her message was? It was a powerful message. It was, no matter what your handicap may be, unless you're completely incapacitated, whatever you can do for the betterment of those around you, you're obligated to do it. Do the best you can, be the best person you can be someone that others want to emulate. Just do the best, be the best you can be at whatever you can do, regardless of whatever handicap you may have. What an inspirational message. No wonder she was so well-loved and well-known all over America as recently as 101 years ago when she died. I have a great affection for the country of Poland, stemming from one of several visits there in 1986 when Poland was still governed by a communist regime. And so in this series of real heroes, you'll see several Poles. And I want to work towards a conclusion by sharing with you the story of at least a couple of them. One of them is a woman named Marie Curie. How many have heard that name before? A great physicist. She was born Maria Sklodowska in Poland. And I just want to tell you a little bit about her and move on to the others, but enough to whet your appetite, hopefully. Do you know that Marie Curie was educated? Her undergraduate degree, no less, was from an illegal underground university. Now think about that. I mean, we're often told that government has to be in the education business. If it isn't, I mean, we wouldn't know to get educated. Well, she actually got her degree in a university that was illegal. It was called the Flying University because it never stayed in any one place very long. It would go someplace else. This was quite common in Poland. In fact, I experienced it in the 80s under communism, but this goes way back, in her case, to the 1880s. Before Poland was reconstituted as a country, it had been partitioned in the late 18th century. It didn't exist as a formal country. It was occupied by Prussia and Russia in particular. But Poles are a stubborn people, and they would not have their culture crushed under the weight of foreign occupying powers. So you name it, any aspect of life in Poland when it didn't exist as a country that was public and legal also had its private and underground illegal counterpart, including universities. And she went on to become, she moved to France later, but went on to become the first woman to win a Nobel Prize, and to this day, the only woman to win two Nobel Prizes. A great hero. Another Pole that I have great affection for was Father Jerzy Papiuszko. How many of you know who he was? He was known as John Paul II's favorite priest. So he's a recent figure. In the 1980s, he was only in his 30s. When martial law was declared in 1981, when the communist government clamped down and banned the Solidarity organization and other organizations promoting peace and freedom, banned them, put thousands of cops in the streets, arresting people, jailing them for simply resisting communist authority. Father Yerzy began a public campaign of speaking out bravely against the tyranny of the communist regime. And they tried everything to shut him up. Communist authorities planted weapons in his apartment and then staged raids, bringing television cameras with them and then putting on television stories of, look, Father Yerzy's trying to start a revolution. Look what we found in his apartment. Poles knew better than that. He would continue to speak out, making the case that it is the duty of every Christian, and of course being a priest, that this is pretty important for a statement for him to make. It's the duty of every Christian to support the freedom of their fellow citizens, Christian or not. He was saying things that people of lesser notoriety would just disappear because of saying these things. An American journalist visited him in 1984. This was written up in the December 85 Reader's Digest, which you can still find, in an article called Murder of a Polish Priest. This American journalist visited him and asked him, Father Yerzy, if you continue to speak out on behalf of freedom in Poland, how can you expect, not expect something terrible to happen? They may really, really come after you. And his famous reply was, they will kill me. They will kill me. And then he said, but I cannot remain silent as members of my own congregation disappear or are jailed, beaten, simply for speaking out on behalf of liberty in Poland. And that's exactly what he continued to do. It was in December of that same year, 1984, when Father Yerzy was coming back by car from a town called Bydgoszcz to Warsaw from priestly duties of some sort. And the only reason we know what happened was because the driver of his car escaped, but not until he was a witness to what transpired. Their car was ambushed by three high-ranking members of the Polish secret police. For hours, Father Yerzy was tortured by these three guys. And eventually his body was tossed into the Vistula River. Because the driver escaped, the communist government later had to have a trial, put these guys on trial. They ended up getting off with light sentences. But the driver testified to the brutal treatment that he saw. And one of the secret policemen even said in his testimony, I never knew that a man could withstand such a beating. Father Yerzy was John Paul II's favorite priest. He said so on many occasions because of his bravery, speaking out on behalf of the liberty of Poland. He is Poland's greatest martyr of the last 500 years. If you have an occasion to go to Warsaw, you must stop in at St. Stanislaw Koska Church. That was his church. And you will see his gravesite in the courtyard adjacent to the church with a large stone cross and candles by the dozens still burning to this day. I mean, they're constantly replaced, lit candles all the time, all these many years since this young man of age 37 was killed by communist authorities. A real hero, well known in Poland, should be better known throughout the world. The last guy I want to tell you about is an almost unbelievable story. But I'm happy to tell you right at the outset that there is a movie being made right now that should be out in about a year about this man. His name was Witold Pilecki. The film, incidentally, is being made by an American producer by the name of David Aaron Gray, who was so moved by this story, he said, somebody's got to make a movie of this guy. Witold Pilecki, spelled P-I-L-E-C-K-I. Pilecki was born in 1901, when there was yet no Poland. Poland was reconstituted in 1918 at the conclusion of the First World War, but was immediately embroiled in a war with Lenin's Russia, who didn't want to let it go. That goes on for another 3 years until Poles emerge victorious against the Russians in 1921 and effectively are able to say, we're now a nation again and we're at peace. Pilecki, as a young man, fought in that war against the Russians and was decorated, highly decorated, for his service during that conflict. And you'd think, well, 1921, peace, you know, nobody saw World War II coming around the corner, that Pilecki now, as a young man, would settle down, have a family, and enjoy some peace. Well, he did, for a little while, until 1939. On September 1 of 1939, of course, as a result of an agreement, secret agreement between the Nazis and the Russians, Poland would be invaded from the west by the Nazis, and 2 weeks later by the Russians from the east, divided in half. Pilecki immediately says goodbye to his wife and two young children, both of whom are still living to this day, both of these children. I'm going to visit with both of them in about 3 weeks, in fact, in Warsaw. He says goodbye to his family, joins the resistance against the Nazis and the Russians, forms one of the strongest resistance movements against them both, fights for a year. And then in September of 1940, he comes up with a plan. This is where the story gets almost impossible to believe. At this point, Poles who were fighting the Nazis and the Russians knew that something awful was happening at a place in southern Poland called Auschwitz. They didn't know entirely what was going on there, but they had enough intelligence getting out that they knew something awful was happening. They wanted to get in there to find out and report to the world. Pilecki, as one of the leaders of the resistance, comes up personally with the plan. He says, I will volunteer to go to Auschwitz. Now, the plan depends upon the Germans arresting him and not killing him and taking him to Auschwitz. I mean, that's a big if, isn't it? He doesn't know that that's what will happen, but he waltzes into a roundup of Polish citizens by German troops and is arrested. And lo and behold, he lucks out. He gets sent to Auschwitz. I mean, that sounds like a crazy thing to say. But he gets sent to Auschwitz, where he creates almost instantly a very powerful resistance movement within this concentration camp. His reports that will stream out over the next 2.5 years and collectively are known to this day as Witold's reports, will become the first comprehensive eyewitness accounts of the beginnings of the Holocaust from within a concentration camp. He was managing to smuggle information, documents, whatever he could, out of Auschwitz and ultimately into the hands of British authorities in particular. For about 6 months during that time, he and his collaborators actually are able to build a crude radio transmitter and are transmitting radio broadcasts from inside Auschwitz about what the Nazis are up to. After 2.5 years of captivity and beatings and all the other things that in the article that is on our website, I don't want to go into since you're so close to dinner, but you can just imagine what he had to endure. He's still managing to get this important word out to the West. The Nazis know that something's going on. They, in fact, are able to trace some of his collaborators and execute them. They're getting close to Pilecki when he decides to do what only 143 other people ever did successfully, and that is to escape from Auschwitz. He gets out. Only 143 other people ever escaped from Auschwitz. Then he makes his way 200 miles to the north to Warsaw and becomes one of the leading commanders in the Warsaw Uprising in 1944. This is when the Soviet army, ensconced not far to the east, sits there for weeks on end, allowing the Nazis to slaughter the Polish resistance in this heroic uprising, because they know that a weakened Poland would be easier to occupy and control after the war. Pilecki, after fighting in the Warsaw Uprising and seeing it crushed by the Nazis, is captured and sent to a German prisoner of war camp. Because he went to Auschwitz under an alias, they never, and wasn't Jewish, never had a tattoo, the Germans fortunately never made the connection that this is the guy, we got him now, this is the guy who was running the resistance within Auschwitz. They never made that connection. So he's in German captivity now for the remaining months of the war. When the war is over in May of 1945, for the first time in years, Pilecki enjoys a little bit of freedom, 3 months. The Polish army in the summer of 1945 sends him to Italy. So all he got to do was to be reunited briefly with his wife and two kids, and now he's back in the army in another country. It's becoming apparent in 45 that the Soviets are not going to leave Poland. And so the Polish army says, we need some undercover people to go back into Poland and start reporting about what the Soviets are doing to our country. And Pilecki at that point is, I mean, he's their number one undercover guy. So he gets sent back into Poland with the mission of spying on the Soviets, which for 2 years he will do effectively until his cover is blown. He was arrested, tortured, put on a very public trial. You can still see pictures of that trial, and if you Google his name, you'll see pictures of him during that trial. And at the age of 47, the Soviets had him executed. The story then kind of fades away. The communist government, until its fall in 1989, would not allow Pilecki's, even his family, were not allowed to speak of him in public. Why? Because if they told the story of his resistance to the Nazis, they'd have to follow it up with what he did afterwards. And this communist regime did not want people to know that this guy was also very anti-communist. So they swept it under the rug, and the story was not widely known until after the fall of communism in 1989. Well, his son and daughter are still living. And if you type in his name into YouTube, Pilecki, you'll find a video of his son, Andres, just last August at a rally in Warsaw to commemorate Witold Pilecki speaking. And he looks just like his father. And I'll be able to meet him for the first time in just a few weeks. Well, what a hero. And thank God there are people in this world, now and in the past, who have been willing to put everything on the line on behalf of this noble objective that we call liberty. If you look at the history of the world, you'll find that very few people really have ever lived in what could be called a significant measure of liberty or freedom. Very few. It's a single-digit percentage. Most people who have ever lived have lived under slavery or serfdom, or at least under total fear that those in power might snuff them out at the drop of a hat. The portion of people who could be said to have lived under freedom is, I'm quite certain, is a single-digit number, single-digit percentage. That means what? Freedom is precious, isn't it? It's rare. It's worth fighting for. And we all owe a debt everywhere in the world to those who have put all on the line on its behalf. I hope I've given you just a little taste of a few heroes in various walks of life. We'll want to read more. In a day and in an age when it seems as though heroes are few and far between, maybe we need to dust some more of them off and get inspiration from what they've done for humanity. Thank you so much, and if we have time, I'll take some questions. Thank you.
I was wondering, the hero Navy who hopes to be on the $10 bill, are you sure there's going to be any cash around at that time?
The question is, will there be any cash around by 2020? Well, that's a good question. It may not be worth very much to put her picture on it. I don't know. But yeah, that's another issue, and one that I'm very concerned about.
I do have a great love and affection of the Polish people. I went through the Second World War in Britain, and quite a lot of Poles were able to escape to Britain, and they were some of the most wonderful people I've ever met.
Yeah.
I'd like to ask, as Churchill said, democracy is a bad form of government, but it's the best we have.
Yeah.
The thing is with the dictatorship, they take too much money from the people. I mean, the communists took almost all of the money from the people.
Mm-hmm.
The democracies are a bit more careful. They know they can take it so far, but that really normally stop, hopefully. America was formed as a truly democratic nation in that. At the time of the highest form, of course, that is now depleted to a large extent. It's a totally different country from what it was.
We're working on that.
I mean, the British reporter was in California, and they're having an election, and there were 249 items to vote on. Mm-hmm. And he said, is democracy gone mad?
Yeah.
I mean, is there any hope for democracy?
Is there any hope for democracy? Well, I know what you mean by that term, but I hasten to remind all of us that technically no country is, nor should be, a democracy in the purest sense. We don't put everything up for a vote. We are a republic, but with democratic tendencies, with protections for things like individual rights. So if I could just slightly reword your question, is there any hope for a limited government constitutional republic? I'm an eternal optimist. I really am. I don't see the point of pessimism. I know that there are many trends going in the wrong direction right now, and you might say, well, there's good reason to be awfully pessimistic, but nobody knows the future. And it can turn sometimes on a dime. And when that happens and you look back and you say, wow, how'd that happen? Then you start to realize, well, it happened because good people who knew what the right thing to do was never gave up. In spite of all the obstacles, they fought hard. It didn't matter what the chances for success were. They knew what was right, and they knew that people of solid character work for what's right, whether they seem to have chances for success in the near term or not. Well, then big changes happen. You never know what the confluence of events and personalities and ideas might be that could come together sometimes quickly and change things dramatically, sometimes for the worse, but sometimes for the better. So I think you have to be optimistic. And there's several reasons for that. One, as I just mentioned, you don't know the future. What's the point of being pessimistic? And there are examples in history where big changes for the better have happened at a time when everybody thought it was never going to take place. But a second reason is, if you're pessimistic about the future, that's a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you're pessimistic, you're not going to work very hard for what you know to be right, and you're not going to be very effective at convincing others to join your cause. I mean, if I told you, hey, I got an idea here, I want you all to work for it, but I want to tell you up front we're going to lose. I mean, who wants to sign up for that? I mean, you've got to exude optimism. So I don't know what the future holds, but I do know that we will lose it all if we give up. Yeah. So you work for what you know to be right, regardless of the odds or what appear to be the chances for success. You work for what you know to be right, let the chips fall where they may. There's one of my favorite passages of the New Testament is from Paul. And he wrote this on the night before his martyrdom. And he said, I have finished the race. I have fought the fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now, you could apply that to a lot of different walks of life. But I think what he was saying was, look, once I knew what the right thing was, I committed myself to it. I wasn't perfect. I didn't win every battle. But I can look back and say that once I knew what the right thing to do was, I never let up on my commitment. We all ought to put ourselves in a position where we can say something like that someday. Joan Thompson could say that. she could look back and say, now she wasn't the type of woman who would brag about such things, but if you pressed her, I think she'd have to agree that once she knew what the right thing was, she never gave up. She never equivocated. It didn't matter to her what the odds were. She never said, well, I guess I'll temper my belief since it doesn't look like we're going to win it next year. I mean, a hero doesn't do that. A hero works all he or she can, as hard as he or she can, for what he knows to be right. So that's how I would answer the question. Be optimistic.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Reed, you spoke of heroes going back, excuse me, as early as in 1945. Mm-hmm. Who are the current day heroes in your opinion? I mean, just maybe give me maybe two or three heroes in the current time that you would consider to be heroes.
Presently living.
Yes. Well, let's say 1945 to 2016.
Oh, well, one that comes to mind that just passed away 3 years ago was Margaret Thatcher. Wow, what a hero. But here's a group of people. No particular name, but you know, I think homeschool parents are heroes. All across the world, there's a homeschool revolution underway of parents who have decided.
This was prepared. It was not prepared.
I think they are heroes because they have decided the care and education of my children is not a function of the government. It's something I am responsible for, and so I just admire homeschool parents. I think that's going to be one of the salvations of our country if that movement continues to grow.
But in the homeschool parents part, it almost the is it homeschool parents part of the ladies are showing signs, profound signs of cynicism in the system. When you say,
I think many that is a motivator on the part of many parents. Yeah, they're just unhappy and for good reason with the system as it is, and they want to do something about it. They're not going to just say, "Well, I'm unhappy, but I'll just be a part of it."
How do homeschool parent kids own nine morality and ethics unless they go on the playground?
How do homeschool kids learn morality and ethics unless they go to, well, they learn it from their parents. And homeschool kids, you know, there's this old stereotype that, well, they're just shut in and they don't meet anybody. That's homeschooling of maybe 300 years ago, but not homeschooling today. They are actively engaged in associations, in collaborative activities, and all the time. They're interacting with people of all ages all the time. And there's a good argument to be made that more children probably need to be interacting with older people than just those of the same age all day long. I think there's an emerging consensus among sociologists that there's a huge advantage in the upbringing of children for them to be interacting with parents and older people. So if you go to our website, type in homeschool, or just go to that series, Real Heroes. I have a lot of statistical information in the piece that deals with them, showing that they're outperforming their peers in one measure of student achievement after another. They're being widely accepted at prestigious universities. Universities want them because they know that they're learners. At least in America, I don't know about what it may be like in the Bahamas, but in America, it is a growing and extraordinarily successful phenomenon. Not for everybody, but for those parents who choose it and sacrifice to do it, I just am full of admiration for them.
John Taylor Gatto is another hero.
Yes, John Taylor Gatto, New York Teacher of the Year in the public system, like 25, 30 years ago, and now has been for years a very outspoken advocate of alternatives to the typical public school. He's written several books. Yeah, he's a hero. Yes, Peter.
Could you say a word about the effectiveness of think tanks and your own Mackinac Institute and so on? I must say, with the Nassau Institute, we work away carefully and we hope efficiently, but we wonder whether we have very much effect on central government. Could you say a little bit about the work that you do and the effectiveness towards libertarianism?
Yes.
In the U.S.?
You know, when you're working in the field of ideas, you have to have patience. You plant the seeds, and sometimes unexpected events and personalities arrive on the scene, and suddenly you may make a spurt of progress that you didn't anticipate. But you couldn't have made it had you not been planting the seeds before. I remember in my 21 years at the Mackinac Center in Michigan, we decided, I think it was maybe our third year when we were tiny, we decided one of our objectives would be to make Michigan one of the strongest unionized states in the country. We were going to make Michigan a right-to-work state, which means no worker could be compelled to join or pay dues to a labor organization as a condition of employment. And I heard endlessly, even from our best friends, oh, good luck with that one. Oh, that'll never happen. Well, I applaud your efforts, but well, I'll be long gone if that ever happens. Over and over again, we had people say, that'll never happen. This is the state of the United Auto Workers, the strongest of the state teacher unions right here in Michigan. We said, it's going to happen. We're going to make it happen. We got a strategy to make it happen. We're going to chip away at the union's special privileges and their ability to speak with authority about things pertaining to kids. And when that day comes that Michigan is a right-to-work state, and everybody says, holy cow, how'd that happen? We'll be able to hold our heads proudly and say because it happened because when everybody said it couldn't, there was a small number of us who said it will happen and we're going to make it happen. I'm happy to say that 3 years ago in December, Michigan became a right-to-work state. And now West Virginia last week. So I know sometimes progress can be glacial. But we went into that battle not knowing how long it might take, but we knew that freedom and labor representation was a critical component of our state's revival. It has to happen. So it's the right thing to do. So we're going to work for it. We didn't care how long it took. So I know sometimes you get down, but don't let it get to you because these things take time. And just keep working at it. Think tanks have been enormously influential, but not nearly, it's not been nearly yet enough, there's no question about it. But I do know this, that what really determines the course of any society is ideas. And if the right ones are not propagated, if the right ideas are not planted, if nobody's speaking out for them, regardless of the odds, well then the bad ideas will automatically prevail. So what are we left with? You work for the good ones and let the chips fall where they may. Don't let the timetable gets you down because nobody knows what that is. So I just take great joy in the message because you know it's right. People will be free. This is inspiring. It's one of the most noble things that anybody can work for. And you do it whether the chances for success this month or next year are good or bad. You never know. Things can turn on a dime. Yes, sir. Before I finish, okay, let me add something to that because I didn't tell you what we're doing at FEE, and I have a colleague here from FEE. I'll never get home tonight without to my hotel safely if I don't tell you something. I can tell you that I have always been an optimist, but I'm even more so now in the 8 years I've been at FEE, because we target young people, high school and college kids, and our programs are just growing up. They're off the charts in every direction. We had a goal for 2016 of reaching 10 million visitors to the website, which was double what we had last year. We're now at a run rate already, and it's just February, of 12 million visitors. It's just going through the roof. The numbers of applicants to FEE seminars exceeding the numbers that we can take by a factor of three. We had three times as many applicants as we can take, even though we keep growing the programs. Among young people, Not all of them, because there were 20,000 at a Bernie Sanders rally in Atlanta yesterday. But among a lot of them, it's just a matter of being exposed, in most cases for the very first time, to ideas of liberty, and you open their minds. Very few people are socialistic because they've thoroughly read our side and decided it doesn't hold up. They just don't know our side. They never heard it. So in that sense, our task might be a little easier than you think. We just got to reach more for the first time, spend a little time with them, and most of the time, you get an avid enthusiast who wants to know more. So that's been our experience at FEE. We're working all the time to get better at how to message and how to market to young people. But wow, just so far, I've just been so encouraged by it all. So, and I don't know if we have time for another, but...
Last question.
Okay, one more.
Hello. Do you think your opinion, the message, or the leader defines the time, or the times defines the message, or the leader?
Or the leader?
Yeah.
Be the personality, particular person?
But the times define the leader, or the leader or the message define the times?
Well, I don't know that it's really all one or the other. I think it's a bit of both. I think you look at a Churchill, clearly, he was shaped by his times, but he also helped to shape the times. There's a little bit of both factors. I think that's probably usually the case.
You have a presidential race right now. They were among the Republicans, but the Democrats.
Yeah.
It seems Trump and Bernie Sanders being in the spotlight seem to be defined by the times rather than maybe finding the times, don't you think?
Well, I can't say it's all one or the other. I think it's a little bit of both. I'm not sure which weighs more heavily.
Okay.
Surely they're both doing as well as they are because of a reaction on the part of a lot of people
to
business as usual.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're reacting in the wrong direction. So I can't clearly say it's one or the other. I'm not happy with those two guys either, by the way. Hey, thanks everybody. Really appreciate it. Thanks again for this.
Before I ask George Borlandelli to come up and give the vote of thanks, I was remiss in mentioning that we have Joan's daughter, Christina Cox, here from Owen Sound, which is where Parry Sound, which is near where the Underground Railroad ended in Ontario. So I thought that was a kind of unique little connection there. And also we have Joan's son-in-law, Peter Phillips, in the back there. So Joan's influence is still among us. It's my pleasure to ask George Borlandelli, our secretary, to come and give the vote of thanks.
Many thanks to you, all supporters of the Nassau Institute, for being in the first Joan Thompson Memorial Freedom Lecture, the first of many. Many thanks to Larry for his speech and inspiration. Following on his warlike message, I want to rescue one of the things he said about the ideas war. We are at war. We are losing. And all of us are, in a way, participants. We are winners in the war of ideas. We are losers, as the people who believe in freedom are at this moment, or are simply collateral damage. For those of you who haven't the time or the inspiration to participate, I please ask you, stop being just collateral damage and join. It's better to know why you're dying or why you're losing. The war of ideas, I say, we're losing because whatever we have now, the poor choices in the United States presidential election are the consequences of the war of ideas and the battles that were lost many years ago and the product of the educational system of today, which is also a consequence of that war of ideas. We need to carry on because I am not an optimist, as Larry says, but I follow the message of somebody who was also a hero. He followed, although Larry didn't sing today, the story of how Ludwig von Mises escaped from Nazi Germany is very similar to the way of the von Trapp family. And he didn't say either this, but this hero of liberty was welcomed with open arms by Fee. And another coincidence, his whole works, which were discovered in probably a former KGB archive, are in Grove City College. So there are a lot of coincidences. Unfortunately for the mothers who dedicated their lives to school, to homeschooling, the fight is not over. Now you have to continue doing it yourself for the rest of the family. And you need to bring in your children into this fight. There is a chapter in one of, I would say, the magna opus of Ludwig von Mises, this hero that I always have in mind, that he made it while he was in Switzerland. He lost it. It was published in German, but he lost it during the war. And he came to the United States, learned to write in English, and wrote it again in 1960. That work is a treatise on economics called Human Action. And in part 7, the last part of the book, it's a message to everybody, not only economists or thinkers that were, let's say, the people he dedicated this work to. This message is for lay people. And if you don't want to read the whole part 7, please read chapter 38. And it will tell you why it is important to learn the problems of today. I'm not an optimist, but I am a, what I jokingly call an apocaloptimist. I think there's going to be trouble, but at the end we're going to be fine. And I totally agree with the gentleman who said that probably is not a very big honor for poor Harriet to appear in the tent. He substitutes a real devil, Mr. Hamilton. But it would have been much better if Harriet would have been remembered with a gold coin. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everybody. I hope you'll spread the word for next year's lecture and our upcoming session. Please feel free to join us tomorrow night at College of the Bahamas and hear Mr. Reed's other lecture.
What time?
Sorry, 6:30 as well in the Harry C. Moore Auditorium. Sorry, DaCosta, you had a question?
Just a statement, because I've never met Mrs. Thompson, but I've heard so much about Mr. Reed, having only been a new director at the Institute. And when I saw the topic, Real Heroes, what's that all about now? Because I really thought it was going to be some talk about economics or libertarianism or something. And I settled back as he came up to say, Real Heroes and from the past. But at the end of it, it was so relevant to where this country is right now, because we are all facing so very many issues, and we need people to stand up and do something. There is so much rhetoric in this community, and very precious few people
do anything. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you again, ladies and gentlemen. We look forward to seeing you another time.